These are various characteristics of a computer. So here speed means how the speed the transaction will be executed. Any commands or any statements or any work that we have specified to the computer, with how much speed is executing. That is called the speed of the computer. We are designing with the i3 processor, i2 processor, which increase the number of speed of the transactions. Next one, accuracy. What is meant by accuracy? For example, if I have write a program and I want to get output, whether the output is correctly coming or not, that is called accuracy. For example, if I want to add two numbers, the result should be the clear and perfect. Otherwise, we cannot say it is not accurate. Deliance. So means deliance means dependency. How it is dependent on the how the people are able to depend upon this, how we are confident and depend upon the computer. The deliance means the dependency. And versatility. So versatility here, nothing but the concept of using a different systems. For example, if I prepared application in this system, can I able to open in the other system or not? This is called the versatility. The reliability. Reliability means if I purchase a system, or if I install the application on the system, can I reliable on the output that is given? That is called the reliability. Reliability equals to its confidenceness. Is how we can say the computer is reliable. You see an example. Generally, best example is the computer cannot think on its own. And you see, whatever the input you are giving, the same output will be displaying. If you give a proper input, it will display a proper output. If you give a fake input, it will give a fake output. So it means the computer cannot think on its own. So we cannot say sometimes reliability is there, sometimes not reliability. Automation. Means all the systems can be automated. See an example, we prepared a document and I can use it later. We prepared a statement, then I can use it later. That is called automated. See an example, opening an account in the bank or depositing withdrawals from the bank, these are called automations. Automation nothing but predefined and reused for further purposes. And memory, so means how the storage capacity of the computer, that is called over the memory. So memory is nothing but the storage area. So means how effectively the computer stores the memory. So what is the size of the memory? So we are telling that 1 terabyte, 500 GB and 800 GB like that. So here, there are the characteristics of a computer. An examination point of view, if they ask a short answer question that what are the characteristics of a computer, you tell speed, accuracy, deliance, versatility, reliability, automation, memory. Speed means how the speed the operations are taking place in the computer. Second one, accuracy means when I write a program, how the output should be. The output is accurate or not. Deliance means what is the confidence of the information that is providing. That is deliance. Means, for example, if I want to perform the task in 10 minutes, but it will take the 20 minutes, we cannot diligence on the computer. So versatility. So it means that how can it be changing to one platform to another platform? For example, I have prepared a document in Windows. Can I able to open the Unix? Can I open it to another system? What the statement that I prepared in the system? Can I able to open another system? That is called the versatility. Reliability means once you prepare the document or whatever it may be, how confident can be the document this same? For example, I transfer the data from one place to another place. Can you say that the data is completely transferred or not? That is called the reliability. Automation, that because of using the computerization, transaction will be automated. And because of the automation, those can be used later whenever necessary. Memory means how the storage is. What is the concept of storage is actually called memory. So what is the concept of storage here? Means that is the computer, what is the capacity of the storage of the data? So how much data can be stored? that is called the memory. We can say then GBs or TBs, terabytes, etc. What is the evaluation of the computers? And the evaluation of computer, it is evaluated as Charles Babbage. See, a significant advance in the evolution of the computer systems was invention of the mechanical adding machine in 1642, a French scientist. You forget about those things. If they ask in the evaluation, what is the evaluation of the computer? Then you have to say, in 1792, 1871, Charles Babbage invented a computer in the England, Cambridge, England. Was the first, first digital computer. The first digital computer was invented by Charles Babbage between 1792 and 1871 at Cambridge, England. So after that, it became as a differential engine. Became as a 1822, it became as a difference engine. In 18, it became as an analytic engine, analytical machine, and so on. So evaluation of computer is nothing but when it is introduced and how it is developed. That is called the evolution of a computer. See, this is one of the important question, maybe long answer question or short answer question, that write a block diagram of a computer, a short answer question. Otherwise, explain the components of a computer. That is a long answer question. So here, see, when you see, we have four types of device in this one. One is an input device, output device, storage device, and control device. So here, input device is used to give input data to the system. If I want to write something, I have to input. The input can be done with the keyboard or mouse or joystick, whatever it may be. Output, if you want to get the information from the system, you have to use the output devices. Example, monitor, printer, etc. So here, the control device is a device that is used to control the all parts of the computer. So here, what are the all parts? Input device or output device or storage devices. What is the storage device? What is the storage unit? Storage unit is a combination of the primary storage and the secondary storage. Combination of primary storage and secondary storage. When you input data, we first go to the storage, and storage to the control unit, and control unit to the storage, again to the output. That is called the process of when you type anything, first it will go to the storage unit. From there, it will go to the control. From there, it will go to the again storage unit, and again go to the output. So what is the need of going to the control unit here is it has to know with the input what how to do. Whether I want to perform the arithmetic calculations or logical calculations, if you want to perform arithmetic or logical calculation, then it has to go to the control unit and perform the operations. And again, it returns to the storage unit. That is the flow. So this is a total device. Here we have four groups: input device, output device, storage unit, and control device. Input device have single unit, output device has single unit, and the storage device has two units, primary storage and secondary storage, and control device has two units. One is the CU, control unit, and ALU, arithmetic logic unit. Here, control unit and arithmetic logic unit together, we can call it a central processing unit. CPU, central processing unit. So this is a block diagram of a computer. This is a very, very important question. And I have described this differentiation here also. What is CPU and ALU, CU, MU? In the examination point of view, they may ask a short answer question that explain the concept of ALU or the MU. So ALU means arithmetic logic unit, which is used to perform the arithmetic and logical operations. Arithmetic operation means addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. And logical operation means comparison of two numbers. Whether it's greater than or less than, greater than, equal to, not equal to, equal to. These are called the arithmetic logic operators. And the control units, what is the use of the control unit means? The control unit will be the mediator between the input device, memory unit, and output devices. So control unit controls all the remaining devices, which are called the input device, output device, and memory unit. So memory unit is a unit which is used to store the data. So memory you did classify to two categories, primary memory and secondary memory. What is CPU? Central processing unit. Central processing is a combination of control unit and arithmetic logic unit. If they ask individually in the examination point of view, explain CPU, and you have the central processing unit, which is a combination of ALU and CU, and you have to explain what is the ALU and the CU. You see, what are the components of the computer system? Here the components are this one, the keyboard, mouse, monitor, printer. Here these are called input devices, output devices. See, input goes to here, either mouse or keyboard. Once it enters the input devices, input port will receive, then it will take to the memory. In memory too, it will go to the arithmetic or logical unit, whatever operation you perform, and they can go to the memory and go to the output screen through monitor or printer. This is about the structure. This entire thing we can call as a motherboard. Motherboard contains control bus, address bus, data bus. It contains three buses: control bus, address bus, data bus. Control bus means how the devices are controlled around the system. That will indicate the control bus. See here, the control bus from input devices to the possibility to the output device and also to the RAM. This is the control bus. Where in case of address bus, we have input address, RAM address, and output address. The same way with the data bus point of view, input, output, RAM, and also we have another thing that is called microprocessor. So this is the structure. If they ask the what are the components of the computer, don't get confused too much. Just remove this one. In this place, just you add the CPU. Just add the CPU and memory. That's all. So what are next? This is a very, very important question. Long answer question. What are the different generations of computers? There are 5 generation: first generation, second generation, third, fourth generation. The first generation is used in the vacuum tubes, developed by the vacuum tubes. In 1940s, you have to remember the generation name and the year between and the unit that is used. So first generation, 1946 to 1959, used vacuum tubes as a basic components for the memory and circuitry of the CPU. Okay. So what is a vacuum tube? These are similar to the electric bulbs. So how it will happen? So when you produce a lot of heat and the installation are used to fuse it frequently. So means when you heat it, then it will be able to store the data. When you clear the heat, this discharge the data. So by heating the vacuum tubes, we can able to store the data. In this generation, so they used punch cards, paper tapes, magnetic tapes, and are used in the first generation. So here, what is the use of the first generation? Vacuum tube technology, unreliable, so means you cannot believe the data, supported machine language only, so means they can understand only zeros and ones, very costly because you have to invest a lot of money on it. Generating a loss of heat because of heating the vacuum tubes, you will get a lot of heat also. Slow input and output devices. So means that because of this vacuum tubes, it will take a lot of time to heat. So output and input also will get delayed. Size will be big. Definitely we need AC because of heavy heat, we are able to control the room. This is non-portable because you cannot carry easily. Portable means you can easily carry. Non-portable means you cannot easily carry. It's consume a lot of electricity because you have to blow the number of bulbs. So some computers are ENIAC, EDIAC, UNIAC. So you have to remember one thing: first generation, 1946 to 1959, vacuum tubes. That's it. Next, what is the use means? It is unreliable. Is very cost, huge size, need AC. 4 to 5 points, non-portable. Remember 4 to 5 points. And examples are ENIAC, EDIAC. The second generation, in 1959, they used the transistors. Transistors, small items which are used to store the data. So here, transistors are cheaper as compared to the vacuum tubes. They are less size as compared to the vacuum tubes. They will more powerful than the vacuum tubes. They use the assembly language. Earlier, first generation used the machine language, binary language, 0-1. Here they use the assembly language. Example, Fortran, COBOL. So, advantage here. So here examples are IBM 1620, IBM 7094 examples. These are the examples. So you have to remember the second generation, they use the transistors. They are more powerful than the vacuum tubes. They are more reliable than the vacuum tubes. They request less space, less cost. Examples, IBM 1620, IBM 7094. Third generation, in 1965 to 71, they use the ICs called integrated circuit. Integrated circuit, nothing but a group of the transistors. It contains many transistors and a single unit. If a single unit contains many transistors, you can say it is an IC, integrated circuit. So third generation, 1965 to 71, uses an integrated circuit that is called ICs. A single has many ICs, many transistors and resistors and capacitors. The development made the computer small. Example, these are IBM 360 series, PDP. These are the two examples. What is the advantage of this one? It is their IC used, so more reliable, smaller size, faster. So it means that you have to remember what are the disadvantages that will become as advantage in second generation, and what are the disadvantages, advantage or more advantage in third generation, so on. Here the fourth generation, here we are the microprocessors called very large scale integrated circuits. So VLSIs are nothing but a number of ICs are installed on the system. So it means that if the number of ICs are installed on a single unit, that is called the VLSI, very large scale integrated circuits. They have about 5,000 transistors and other circuit elements. So they use the high level languages, C, C++, basic. In first case, they use binary level language. Second case, they use assembly level language. In third case, they use the other second level language and also some high level languages. And fourth case, completely use the high level language like C, C++, etc. For example, DEC 10 start 1000. Next one, last one, the fifth generation. Fifth generation is in 1982 to till date. So in the fifth generation, VLSI technology becomes a ULSIC. Very large scale integrated circuit becomes as a ULSIC, ultra large scale integrated. So ultra large is more than the VLSIC technology. So the production of the microprocessor. It is nothing but the production of the microprocessor chips. So the fifth generation is lead to the artificial intelligence. They use the C, C++, Java, .NET and everything. Examples are laptop, desktop, what we are using all the fifth generation. So you have to remember first generation vacuum tubes, machine level language, second generation transistors, assembly language, third generation ICs, integrated circuits, it's a combination of number of transistors, resistors and capacitors. That is example are high level language. And fourth generation we have VLSI, very large scale integrated circuit. Examples are C, C++, etc. Fifth generation, fifth generation high level language, then high level language ULSI ultra scale, ULSI integrated circuits, very large scale integrated circuit, ultra large scale integrated circuits, and examples are desktop, laptop, notepad, ultra tabs, Chromebooks, etc. So next one, what are the classification of computers? So here up to this one, the questions may be the what are the characteristics of a computer? Next one, what are the generations of a computer? And next one, explain the block diagram of a computer. So now next question is the classification of computer. So how the classifications computers are classified? So computers are basically classified based upon the size and the performance. Example, PC, personal computer, where we use regularly in your system, in our home. A single user computer system having moderately powerful microprocessor. Yes.
Sir, can you send that last year question paper?
Which one?
Last year question paper.
Last year question paper.
Huh.
I will post, no problem.
Okay. So, and also important questions also.
It is single user computer system having moderately powerful microprocessors, workstations. It is as a single user computer, similar to personal computer, however more powerful. So it means PC workstations are more powerful than the PC. PC where we use at home, workstations are available companies. Mini computer means it is multi-user computer operating system. Here in the both case, only the single user operates. Here the multi-user will operate. Okay. Here the mainframe, next one. It is a multi-user operating system capable of supporting hundreds of users simultaneously. Simultaneously, software technology different from the mini. So these both are same, but the technology will be different. Software technology will differ. Supercomputer, it is extremely the fast computer which can execute hundreds of millions of transactions per second. So these are the classification of computers. Next, applications of computers. So means where we use the computers. So we can use it home purpose. We can use it in medical fields, to in the medical hospitals. We can prepare the bills. We can prepare statements. We can prepare the scan reports and everything. Entertainment for watching movies and preparing or playing games, etc. Industries to design the various products and etc. Education to explain the tutorials or classes and online classes and everything. Government to generate the e-seva services to give the facilities to the customers. Banking to give the online banking facilities and depositing facilities, etc. Business to buy and purchase something, and training to get a class. For example, if you want to join the institution, they will give the online training providing, etc. Arts, if you want to design some arts, or if you want to prepare a coral draw, paintbrush, architectural designs, etc. That comes to science and technology. So in the weather reports, if you want to prepare a missile technologies, otherwise somewhere you can able to use. So there are the different applications. I mean, everywhere we can use the computers. See here. Computer used at home for several purposes like online bill payments, watching movies, show at home, home tutorials, social media access, playing games, internet, etc. In hospitals, they prepare the database of the patients, diagnosing, x-rays, monitoring the patient. Computers can also have to watch movies online, play games. There are so many examples and useful for the computers. Banking sector, we have different users. In science and technology, we are using research and development. what are the benefits of computer? So benefits of the computer, first week accuracy. So data should be accurate to the computer. For example, if you made a calculating of 10 numbers addition, you can make mistake, but the computer never mistake. Reliability is a quality due to which the user can stay depend upon the computer. So it means that whatever I want to get, that should be delivered by the system. Adaptability, anybody can understand the computer language. Anybody can easily understand the computer, how to get anything. So simple as well, the complex. Computers are normally versatile unless designed in specific operations. So it means anybody can use the computer system generally, except some systems which are the business or scientific related systems, etc. Every system can be easily adaptable to anybody. So it means the system that is used by me, you can able to use the same system also, no problem. Next one, come to the point of storage. Storage is the ability of the computer to store the data in itself by accessing. For example, how do the store in the computer system? So the ability of the computer to store data itself for accessing it again. Nowadays, apart from having instantaneous access to data, see here, we have so many devices using the computer. Example, pen drives, floppy drives, CDs, DVDs, hard disk drives, external disk drives, etc. There are so many drives we can be able to use in computers. So because of this one, what are the benefits of the computer means? You can get the accurate data. The data can be reliable. Anybody can adaptable to the system, and the storage is very easy. What are the limitations? Limitation nothing but the negative points or disadvantages. Once the disadvantages, the limitations are both are same. Lack of common sense. It means that the computer cannot think. She is not able to take a decision. Whatever you say, it will do. Whether it true or false. That is a main drawback of the computer. Zero IQ. So it cannot think on its own. The computer doesn't have any IQ, intelligence quotient. They are unable to see and think the action to be performed in a particular situation unless the situation is already programmed into it. See an example, better example, robo movie. So means the technology can be used for both positive and negative. So computers can be used for positive attributes and negative attributes also. So hackings. When you're hacking something, the computer cannot stop, don't hack like this, because the programmer, whatever the programmer tell, that will do. So lack of decision making, it cannot take any decisions. For example, a best example, when you're driving a bike, you can able to control that when vehicle is oppositely come to you. But when there is a problem occurs, they cannot think, the decision cannot taken by the computer. Unless you have provided security. Example, I have send a virus to the system. So it is know that the virus is entering, but it cannot stop until you install the antivirus software. So means it cannot take the decisions. They can be programmed to such a decisions which are purely procedure oriented. We have defined something, they can take the call. Otherwise, they don't take the call. So limitations means here, lack of common sense, zero IQ, lack of decision making. There are three disadvantages of the computers. What is the input device roles? What they have to do. So input device sends information to the computer system for processing. So means if you want to enter something into system, then you have to use the input device. And if you want to get out of the system, then you have to use the output. Meanwhile, there's something happen that is called the processing. Input device only allow for input the data into the computer, and the output device only allows input or receive the output for the data from the another device. So what are the input device? Keyboards. Example, so many examples are there. What are the keyboards? Keyboards, next one, terminals. Terminals are nothing but the device, those are connected to the computer. So there are so many devices. Example, USB device, your printer, scanner, monitor, LCD screen, whatever it may be. Those are all called the terminals. So pointing device means A pointing device or something is called a pointing tool is a hardware input device that will use it to move the mouse cursor in a computer on GA. So here camera phone, camera mouse, computer mouse. So when you see the computer mouse, you can when you move on the computer mouse, the screen, a symbol will move on the mouse. See here, this is called the computer mouse. Finger touch screen. Most of the chief systems are coming that when you touch on the screen, it will automatically application will be opened. Touch screens. Like example, mobile phones, joysticks for gaming purpose, light pen. When you focus on the specific light on the system on the light, it will automatically emboss and degrade. I mean, trackball, touchpad. There are so many things. Keyboard. These are all called the input devices. Scanners and its type. So what are the differences? What is scanner? A scanner is an input device which you use it to get an electronic copy, into the system. So flatbed scanners are there, photo scanners, document scanner, portable scanner. Flatbed scanner means they can able to document anything. You want to take the printout, if you want to scan the official documents or whatever it may be, anything can be possible with the flatbed. Photo scanners are only for the scanning the photographs, documents for to scan the legal documents, portable scanner for the scanners that you can easily carry from one place to another place. What is called as portable scanners. So this is the flatbed scanners. Most of the institutions, most of the internet centers or most of the institutions will take the see the flatbed scanners only. The photo scanners are like this. They will be mostly in e-seva centers. Document scanners, generally you see the official offices only. They cannot see regularly. Portable scanners like this one. So these are basically used in government organizations to do the surveys. When you go to the survey, they want to scan their applications. They cannot take a heavyweight scanners to every place. That's why they will take a stick like the scanners. Then they will keep in the some holders and they will take. We can easily scan from them also. It is called the portable scanners. Voice recognition system. Voice recognition system means when you speak something. That for example, Alexa. Alexa is one of the voice recognition system. By giving the voice, it will take the voice and it convert into the necessary form. If you want to play the audio, Alexa, let you play this video. And automatically takes your voice recognition according to the voice instructions, it will do. So instead of using the keyboard or mouse or touchpad, anything, you can also directly communicate, directly give input to the system through the voice also. What are the output units? Monitors. There are different type monitors, CRT monitors. Olden days we have seen these monitors. Cathode ray tube monitors. TV, olden TV you can see, is it LCD, liquid crystal display, LED, light emitting diodes, monitors, printers and its types. There are two types of printers, impact printers and non-impact printers. Impact printers and impact printers, the type of the printer that operate by striking a metal on the plastic head against the iron ink ribbon. Example, dot matrix printer. Dot matrix printer is the best example for the impact printer. Non-impact printer means a type of printer that does not operate by striking a head against the ribbon. Examples, not printer example of ink. Say example, when you go to the next center, if you want to for color printout, the print will silently come. There is no noise, there is no striking voice, anything. That is called the inkjet printers or laser printers. Those are the non-impact printers. Impact means striking something. See an example. When you go to the railway reservation system, where you go to the bus reservation system, they are trying to print out, it's coming different noise, striking noise. That is called the impact printers. Like dot matrix, when you see clearly, there are so many dots in that one. That's what they call dot matrix printers. Non-impact means there is no dots. That is called the non-impact printers. Examples for non-impact printers are laser printers, inkjet printers. Plotters. Plotters also one of the output devices. Lotus are basically used for designing purpose, preparing the flexes, graphics, vector graphics, etc. It uses one. There are two types of one: drum plotters, flatbed plotters. Drum plotters means when you see in the what is called designing shops, otherwise graphical shops, they can understand. They are flexi business persons. You can understand. They will put a sheet, and sheet will roll, and a strike will be displayed onto the screen. That is called the drum plotters. Flatbed means a sheet will be placed on the flatbed, and the scale will move. The first case, the sheet will move, and scale will design the picture. The second case, the sheet will not move, the scale will move and design the picture. That is called the flatbed plotters. So these are the questions from the unit 1.